So it is now my pleasure to introduce Christina Bergman, who's a postdoc at the Max Planck Institute for Psycholinguistics in Nijmegen, in the Language Development Department, and who's both a computer modeler and an organizer of research networks, and works with participants that are just as difficult as the clinical populations, namely children. And yes.
Thanks. That was a great introduction. Yeah, so I'm a very optimistic person, so I'm trying to talk more about solutions instead of harping on about the problems, because we all know there are problems. So I'm not going to reiterate that. And I'm trying to talk about my field, which is developmental psychology, specifically the corner where we study language acquisition and first language acquisition in babies. And I think that field is actually an interesting case because, as far as I know, we haven't had a big scandal, and yet the field has been extremely accepting and embracing of open science and a lot of aspects of the movement. And yeah, latecomers. I think that's interesting, and I just want to maybe explore with you where that comes from and also whether there are unique solutions because of the tricky population we're working with. So just to give an example why I think that my field is very embracing of open science is I have 6 specialized journals for language acquisition papers where I can submit registered reports. I think that's exceptional, especially for a field that hasn't had a big scandal. So there are journals called Language Learning or Journal of Child Language, which are really obviously specific, and they all offer registered reports in different flavors. So that's one of piece of evidence. The other one is that I regularly, along with other people, get invited to give workshops about open science and get wonderful feedback. Like just last week, I heard that I inspired someone to submit a registered report. So that's really, really encouraging to hear. And I hope that that also goes into the direction of what we just heard, that ECRs are driving change and can help drive change. And talking about open science and keeping the talk going is a good way to affect change. So that's just a few evidence and to give you an idea of the field that I'm in. So let's start with the talk. So baby science is hard. That's one of the reasons why they do cry. They also, they're also adorably cute. And I think it's extremely fascinating what's going on in their little heads. There are people that, because it's hard, have predicted, okay, I need to be closer, that we'll have the next crisis. So had a beautiful fight on Twitter about that just a few months ago. And they're not wrong. Our typical sample size in a set of 12 meta-analyses that I looked at is 20 per group or in a within design. But that's the distribution of effect sizes. So that's really bad, because the mean is 0.48 and the median is 0.4. I let you do the math. It's just very obvious that we're running underpowered studies. So if power is the key factor, then we're doing not so well. But there are, of course, other constraining factors, like in other limited resource sciences, time, money, and ethics. Yeah, so how did this happen? Oops, wrong way. The participants are the problem. They're difficult to recruit, and we shouldn't even test 1,000 babies. So when I look at all these beautiful MTurk studies, I'm not trying to talk them down, with thousands of participants, I see no way, both practically and ethically, to test that many babies. There's no way I can justify to an ethics committee that I need that many participants. They ask me either, why do you design such an inefficient experiment, or what's wrong with you, or why do you want to test a null effect? So let's go to the solutions, because that's what I want to focus on. So one of them is to get creative with sampling. What people do is really not do the classical either sample 500 MTurkers or invite 500 babies to the lab, but they go, for example, to preschools. Or they test the museums and just grab every kid that walks by in a science museum for children and puts that in front of a tablet and lets them just look at little cute movies for 5 minutes. Or develop online test platforms, but still you need this very tricky design, and so it's very hard to test 500 babies within, say, a reasonable time frame. The question that results from this, and that maybe we can all think about it together, is how to then deal with this in pre-registrations. So if we want to have a good sample size, we don't know what the population will be like. So in the museum, if I were to start testing in a museum in the Netherlands, I wouldn't know what the typical socioeconomic profile is, the typical age profile, the numbers I can test within, say, the 10 days I have an agreement with the museum. So I would have, apart from the time limit, no way of predicting how many babies or children I would even have be able to include in my sample. That's a problem, right, if we go from the classical pre-registration model. And I think it's just, maybe interesting to think about. But, well, these are solutions to the fact that getting babies into the lab might be hard. The other solution is to share. And yes, we've talked a lot about sharing and open science, but I want to show you that there's actually a lot out there that you wouldn't expect in developmental science, like those four that I'm going to go through. This is quite fickle, because there's actually a longer tradition in open science than you would expect. Okay, I'm going to just do it like this. I'm going to stand here now. There is, since 1984, the Child Language Data Exchange System, which is an online platform to exchange child language data. We're talking about decades before we really talked about open science and sharing. And the data that is in there covers even more decades. It covers 26 languages, 130 data sets are there, and the main paper that you're supposed to cite when you use this exchange system has over 7,000 citations. And this is what it looks like. So it's not just any data set. It's actually a really useful platform where you have, if existent, video data. So you can watch videos of parent-child interactions, for example. Or you have audio recordings. And you have annotations. And these are, to just go through it, so these are audio-video recordings. And they are carefully transcribed. So people really sit down and annotate what's happening, sometimes just on the word level, sometimes really minute up to the phone level. Just trust me, it's difficult. I mean, Lisa and I have just been arguing about phones, phonemes, etc., pronunciation on Twitter, so it's really hard. And that can take a lot of time. So this is just one estimate that 10 minutes of conversation between a parent and a child can take up to the tenfold to transcribe, depending on the granularity you want to reach. So that's very valuable, costly data that people still share freely. Why do they do that? What happens? So what do you then do with this? You can explore the data, download, analyze. There's even an R package for Childis, by the way. Yay, open source. And you can expand it. So you can also add annotations. And you can then use that for modeling, for designing your studies, for data exploration and hypothesis generation. That's the most frequent use, because in most cases, the people who use it haven't collected it, and they didn't have an a priori hypothesis necessarily. But you can also, of course, take your hypothesis from natural observations and then test that in a corpus. What I forgot to put in there is teaching. It's in every class on language acquisition, people use this, or at least in every class I've ever been part of. So it's an extremely valuable resource. For the contributor, it's quite easy how to contribute, and I think it's just important to illustrate how easy it is. You check whether your data set is suitable, you check whether you have the ethical permission, you have to sign a release form, obviously, check compatibility. I mean, there's, of course, a template that I have to adhere to. Add documentation, metadata is, again, crucial. Send it, and then it's on there. So back to the question, why do people do that? And I speculate here, because I don't have a corpus on Childis, but I'm just looking at why is it so successful. you have an immediate added value. So sharing data is not just this long game, but you have to think of future you or people who might possibly read your paper and ask you for your data. You have this immediate impact that you can see all these visualizations, analyses that you can automatically do with all the tools that are provided along with this data exchange system. And I think that's a really powerful thing that is really motivating. So, just need to breathe. You have a central specialized hub, and that's different from OSF and other platforms. And I'm not saying OSF is bad in that sense, but it's just really nice that if people want this kind of data, they know where to go. And there is a clear citation policy because we still measure success in science in age index, et cetera. So if you have a paper about your corpus and you put the corpus on there, then people, when they use your data, have to cite you. So you get this incremental count. This is, well, it's a bit of a hack because we don't have proper data accreditation yet, but it is a way to at least make sure that you get credit. And so there's another motivating factor. So in the long run, you might, with your corpus, actually accumulate more citations than with any experimental paper. So there are other data sharing initiatives in language acquisition that are similar, and I think they actually try to operate in similar ways. One is WordBank, where people collect questionnaires that parents fill in. This is a really common tool. We just ask, does your child understand and or say this word? And then it's a list of something between 40 and 600 items. Depends on the exact instantiation. And this has been adapted to different languages. It has been normed. So it's not just people coming up with word lists. At least it has been normed. It's also sometimes being renormed. So we try with our measurement. Not saying we succeed. So this is a really common tool, and it's also actually used in therapy, so it's really, really relevant. So there's WordBank now, and that's been established in 2015. And they have a lot of data. They have data from 75,000 children already. And again, the added value, as I show here, is that you have immediate interactive visualizations for your data set. So you upload your questionnaire data in the template format, and you immediately can do all these extra analyses that you might not want to reprogram yourself. So there are lots of parallels. It's a central hub for this kind of data. There's a clear citation policy as well, and you have your analysis and visualizations. And I think that's really interesting because I think within 4 years, this much data is a huge success. If we could do that for other fields, I think that would be really cool. But of course, not everyone contributes. So they've contacted way more people who collect this kind of data. And there are also people who have corpora that they're not sharing freely. And there are reasons why not everyone joins these kinds of efforts. One is that this is really, I should just stay here. One is that, the citation policy, which is the way to get credit for sharing your data in this case, isn't really followed. So this is more for childers. People really say, oh, they use my data in their example. I know this really well because I've worked 10 years with this data set and it's in their paper and they're not even citing me. Might be related to things like citation number limits in journals, but still it's not ideal. So this experience might put people off sharing their data if that's part of the incentive structure. Then we have data protection concerns. They've come to the forefront now with GDPR, but we should actually always think about the data we share and what happens with it and where it goes. So this is actually not a new problem. It's just a problem that's become more urgent because we've had attention drawn to it with GDPR. For all these initiatives, the servers are usually in the US. So all the limitations with especially European data being transported to the US apply. if you want to do that, talk to, if you have that, a data protection officer in your institution or the ethics board. Usually, if you're lucky, you have both. And you'll see that it's really hard. And also anonymization, full anonymization is extremely hard. I just learned that. So there are some justified concerns that might limit sharing. So data protection is a key issue, especially in our population. It might also be true for some clinical or non-weird populations. We cannot get direct consent. And a resulting question is, what happens in 17 years when I test a one-year-old? And I do a video recording, and then I share it freely. In 17 years, they have their right to their own image. They're 18. So if I share this video freely on the internet, do I have to find them again and recontact them again? We're not really sure, actually. So people disagree on what should happen. And people who've been part of these kinds of studies also might disagree. So even though it might be legally fine that I shared a one-year-old's picture or a video, this person might later see it and say, oh, this is horrible, I don't want to be on the internet doing this, like, say, stupid task where I look really silly. So this is, for me, a valid concern that I want to respect as well, because the most valuable thing we have when we work with these kinds of population is having a good relationship with our participants and their parents. So we don't want to ruin that. And we have to play a long game because our labs don't just shut down after 5 years. And most of the data we collect is by definition in some way personal and really near impossible to anonymize. If we have things like birth date, sex location, or a combination of these, it will be really easy to identify the person. Yeah, audio video recordings. I don't even need to explain, I hope. And these are all, of course, problematic, and it's going to be really hard to just share without really, really proper consent that is also long-lasting, because, for example, GDPR requires you to state a limitation of how long you keep the data and to really strongly justify why you want to keep it longer. So you have to make a really strong case, for example. When you make things public, it will be there in principle forever. So you have to make a really strong case why this is strictly necessary. Yeah, etc. So what is the solution? Because I wanted to talk about solution, I didn't want to complain. So let's go back to the more positive side of things. One of the options are levels of access. We usually think of open versus closed data as a binary, but I would say it's a continuum. So and there are even tools out there that give different levels of access. One is at the MPI, where I happen to work, a shameless plug. And the other is, again, a US system, so we have still the server issue. A data query, but at least we can start reasoning about, for example, putting a well-documented data set on a server that is suitable for our purposes and having that only accessible from people within the institute, people who have given their purposes and then get permission for a specific research project, or everyone. And so we can start thinking about access as a graded thing. And for example, the Language Archive offers a comprehensive template for metadata and documentation. And that's really important because contributing my first data to them really taught me what metadata even is and how to start documenting my own data sets. And so that means that we're not in the situation that many worry about, that once we ask for data, the researcher has to dig it up, it's in an unusable format and not documented. But still, it's not openly accessible. So we need to think more in grays. One sec. We can also, of course, share some depersonalized data, like these questionnaires that I mentioned. They can be depersonalized. You can remove birth dates and just add how old they were in some abstract scale, days, months. And that's not as personal as birth date. And another option is what we also do, which I'll talk about in a second in many babies, is we have the raw data. They're not shared. But then we have some processing pipeline. You can share that pre-processing pipeline, for example. You can share how you get from the raw data format to that anonymized or depersonalized data set. Share that one and your analysis script. So that's really great for reproducibility, because these two will be what you use to arrive at your statistics. And well, we also have to work with an honor system. Of course, you promise to not mess with the raw data, right? But there are no open science practices that really, really prevent you from entering your data by hand or something, at least not as far as I know. But we just have to trust that this is as it came out of the computer with the timestamps, etc. And we can see what happened with it in the pre-processing pipeline. And I think that might be a good intermediate solution as well. So you document what you do, and you can still reproduce the results that you report in a paper. Or you could even write an interactive paper that we saw yesterday, like in eLife, where you can actually rerun the analyses, etc. So yeah, this is, what's closed, what's open. Another example, and that's a shameless plug, where we try to build on these ideas is MetaLab, which collects meta-analyses. So it's not participant level, but group level data based on published papers. There we don't have those data protection concerns, typically. And it does provide interactive visualization. So we try to give this added value. These are living meta-analyses, so you can also update them. It's all open, so you can also download a specific data set, change things, add things. It also has this added value. And we share all codes and have something that we call dynamic reports, where whenever we add data and we re-render the site, then these reports are also re-rendered with the most recent data set. So this report, for example, was written, these are all different data sets. This report was written when we had, 6. And this is what it looks like now. So these are just the data sets. So obviously, they are fed into the pipeline. But we want to grow. And I'll leave it on there. For some kinds of research questions, you want to have individual level data. So it would be cool to expand to a multi-level approach at one point. And for that, we want help. So if you're interested in this kind of project, let me know. If you know someone who's interested, we would be eager to grow this. So this is a living project that is happy to grow. And fun fact, MetaLab is apparently so nice that other people approach us from other fields and say, hey, we want to have something like this for us. So I'm working with actually clinical psychologists who want to see whether they can adopt this kind of approach for their field, because they actually have the reverse problem from us. So we didn't have enough meta-analyses in our field. So most of the meta-analyses we have are actually made by one of the people affiliated with MetaLab. But in some clinical psychology fields, whenever there's a new study, there's a new meta-analysis. So you have this inflation. But if you have living documents, you just update the single meta-analysis, and then people can see where the outcome changes. So that's really, really exciting. But I'm not the lead on that. I'm just consulting. So that was about data sharing, and I hope that offered some ways to improve open data beyond just making ECRs do it. But yeah, we still have our participants, and they come with more problems. They're extremely uncooperative. They're really cute, and it's so much fun, but they don't want to answer your questions. So when you take an 80-month-old and ask them, is this a sentence you recognize as grammatical? They say, dada. I don't know. And they're extremely easily distracted, too. So when the game is not interesting enough, if the video is not exciting, or if the room is too dark, they just start playing with their own feet. Those are always more exciting than your study. So we got a little issue with how to measure what they know. So one of the solutions that the field came up with is to constantly improve methods. We started out with really simple methods, with a TV, someone sitting behind a screen, and live noting what's happening. Or with blinking lamps that babies look at, and then the longer they look, the more interested they are in something. And with the advent of eye tracking, we've of course updated, and we constantly basically try to change and improve. But there's a resulting issue. So are all these measurements really tapping into the same thing? And when we just basically try to parcel out the specific research question and just look at the effect of different methods, we do see a method effect. So this is based on data on MetaLab, where we do see that, yeah, probably as an effect of measurement precision and the number of trials you might get, you do see that effect sizes systematically differ according to the method you use. It's not encouraging. So that then, for example, if you want to do a meta-analysis and the field uses multiple methods, you have to take that into account. And it is one of the more robust findings, actually, on MetaLab, that method matters. So the next step is, of course, once you have this kind of result, to do a targeted investigation. And that brings me to ManyBabies. And I call this a slightly different ManyLabs project, but it's more similar to the PsychSciAg than I actually realized. So yeah, we've been talking a bit with you guys, but we need to talk more. But the goal is not to just run a replication, but to design the best test possible. That means really, really arguing about how to set up the experiment, how to design the stimuli, and really come up with strict protocols for everything. Yeah, and create a model best practices to really try to do this whole open science thing and standardize if we can. And one key issue is work together. So it's not that one person decides, oh, I want to run a replication of phenomenon X. It's really a grassroots thing. The first topic was actually decided based on a vote and then on feasibility. But there was, yeah, there was literally a Google Drive poll that people just filled out. There's an added benefit, and that's community building. So that's the one difference to many labs projects, maybe, that these labs that come together for many babies projects actually keep talking. They don't just disband them afterwards. And this is from a meetup this summer where we actually handed out diplomas for things like collected most babies, submitted the data first, and that was just huge fun. And there are also people there who don't participate, and that's always the case at these meetups. So there are people who say, I don't have interest or I don't have the resources, and they're still welcome and they still get to benefit from this nice community. And this is a map, just put it in because I wanted to show off a bit as well. But we do miss the global south in large chunks, we admit that. But it's a pretty nice coverage, it's not just the US and Canada. I'm pretty proud of that. And to give you a framework, so this is 69 labs, we thought we would get 20. So this has been going really well for the first ManyBabies project. And yeah, these labs are really talking continuously, basically. And to talk more about what I mean with develop and model best practices, of course, this is about open science in many ways. And it leads, for example, by talking between labs to procedure-specific best practices, because we don't discuss across labs. Oh, do you end a trial when the baby is bored, or do you just keep playing it until it's over? These little things that might seem obvious to a single researcher, but that are not obvious from, say, reading a paper. We have a set of standardized stimuli that then can be remade, for example, in different contexts or with different twists on them. And we try to model born open data. And that's the other special thing. There are a lot of knock-on projects. For example, one on test-retest reliability. Yay! So that's because our babies are so valuable, we rarely do this. But if we have the best possible design, it becomes actually reasonable to do something like test-retest reliability and re-invite the same participants. And so these projects are minimally pre-registered, and we have two accepted registered reports that are knock-on. So that are not the main project. So what is, just to come back to what we actually looked at, one of the questions, the main question was whether babies prefer infant over adult directed speech, which is one of the foundational assumptions in our field. We talk in a different way to babies than to adults. If we have American people who want to model that, they can do it much better than me because I'm German, and apparently us Germans don't do it so much. But yeah, so if you have an American nearby, ask them to talk to their baby or to an adult, and you'll see the beautiful difference. But because this has been tested in multiple ways, and because labs have different facilities, we basically had to implement it in different methods because we wanted to get as many labs to participate as possible. And so there are three options in which this has been tested. One is where babies look at a screen. So this is from something I'll explain in a second. So there's a screen here. And then there is someone live coding whether baby's looking or not. And the idea is the longer baby looks, the more interested they are. Then we have here an eye tracker, which automatically codes whether baby's looking or not. And here we have a booth with three lamps. And so first the central lamp blinks. And once baby's attention is to the center, one of the side lamps begins blinking. Baby turns because flashing lights are just super interesting. And then either adult or infant-directed speech starts playing. And the longer baby looks, the more attentive it is. And it's usually also live-coded. So this is the person saying, looking or not looking. I should be closer. Running off again. So the good news is we've done the data collection. The stage 2 registered report is under review. Because it's under review, I'm not going to share the final results. But as a sneak peek, yes, methods matter. And oh yes, babies do prefer infant-directed speech, even in Germany, where they're apparently not so used to it. Poor babies. But yes, so this is currently under re-review, which is really exciting, and fingers crossed. So I'll keep you posted, basically. Once it's out, I'll let you know on Twitter. But there's so much more. So this is especially interesting for Joachim. Because labs differ in incidental ways. Because, for example, the researcher might be in the same room. Does that matter? It may be bright or dark. Some people completely turn off the light. Some people leave it on normally. Does that matter? For example, the flashing light might be then more salient. Or babies might get more afraid in the dark. It might be a narrow or a big room. Or they might have a warm-up phase where they get to play. Or they're just put into the test situation right away. And that's actually one of the knock-on projects. Oop. So what we did was really ask labs to record walkthrough videos, which is basically the extension from what Lisa mentioned with the quick videos documenting the procedure. We really tried or asked labs to meet a mom and her baby. So that's a doll in that case. And here it's a teddy bear. At the point where they pick up the parents, go into the lab, do the warm-up, do the procedure, do the debrief, and then really do the whole, basically do the whole test on a video. And it shows incredible variation. So we have these videos for every participating lab. And we can then look at these different aspects, like lighting, room size, etc. This is not completely novel. I don't want to claim we invented this. There's this journal. No, I forget. JOVE. Let's just call it JOVE. Journal of Video, something. They also ask for procedure documentation, but they focus on novel procedures. I think it's equally important to focus on established procedures, just to be sure that we're all doing the same thing, because a method section is never sufficient. So this is the knock-on project I alluded to. One of the questions that you can then ask is, are hidden moderators real? Because you won't report room size or lighting in a paper, but you can ask yourself, does this matter? And will it systematically affect sizes? Why should we look at this kind of variability? Well, the case has been already made, but I'm just going to make it in a different way. Sometimes we don't know what will matter, and there are actually interesting things to discover this way as well. I mean, I hope that things like room size don't matter too much, because what does it say about different sized nurseries? Fingers crossed. But this is, for example, from a recent meta-analysis on babies learning structure from speech that is artificial, completely random syllables tied together, which has statistical structure in it. So it's not like natural speech. It's really boring and flat. And sometimes it's generated by a computer, and sometimes by a human. And it turns out this matters. So this is purely synthetic computer-generated speech. These are syllables chunked together that were produced by a human. And this is really human, fluently produced speech. And the statistical structure children are supposed to discover in those is the same. So what you might notice is that the effect completely flips. This is a completely different direction of the effect than this. So if you use computer-generated speech, you observe one thing. When you use natural speech, another. If you average this out, you have a zero effect size. So, and it, I mean, it kind of makes sense because computer-generated speech is different, does have different properties, and you might want to pay attention to it differently. But we have to explore this more. But if they were just paying attention to the statistics, this should matter. But of course, babies aren't as unidimensional as you'd like them to be. And I mean, that's part of the fun as well. The additional advantages of walkthrough videos are actually quite vast. As I mentioned, it's more information than a method section, and I wanted to add map out method space just because I found it such a nice term. And it's really, you can now make use of incidental variation. It's extremely useful for education. So when I want to tell students about specific procedures in a class, I'll just use those videos from now on. I don't have to draw on a blackboard or use boring diagrams. And it's also a guide when you build a new lab or when you want to set up a new procedure. How did other labs do this? I mean, usually you would have to visit the lab, spend some time there, maybe increase your carbon footprint because you're flying across the globe. And now we have these videos. But there are even more challenges. Just checking. But I don't want to bore you. So I'm just like, yeah, letting that rest for now. And I hope that was a constructive way of going about it. But what I wanted to add is maybe some more food for thought, because there are a few things missing that I think I would like to have a more of a discussion of. For example, clear labels and definitions. So this did come up. We had several speakers clearly define what they mean with different key concepts. And it would be nicer if that hadn't have to happen, if we had agreed on a common definition of pre-registration, preprint, replication, etc. So this leads to things like, this study was pre-registered but not at this journal. I mean, pre-registrations don't happen at journals necessarily, right, as we learned. So we just need to really be clear in our language, I think. What is a replication? They tested different participants. Is it still a direct replication? How do you even respond to these kinds of reviews? I think we could also use way more scaffolding. When I wrote my first pre-registration, I had no clue what I was doing. Of course, it was awful. The data didn't look like I expected at all. I had beautiful non-normal data that I wanted to do tests on that based themselves on the normality assumption. We learned that this is not necessarily a good idea to stick to those plans, so I didn't. But I made clear that this was my pre-registration and this is how I deviated because X, Y, Z. But I think it would just be much, much nicer, easier to have more scaffolding. Also to combat this argument that, oh, it takes too much time for me to be open. One of those is standardizations. I mean, some things are already standardized. The data sharing efforts all come with standardized templates that I mentioned. But there are more, so this is a video annotation standardization effort, and PsychDS has already been mentioned. I think these are extremely important to make open science even easier. And we need field-specific resources, because one common argument is that, this is really interesting for social psychologists, but I don't even know how to adapt this to my field, or this is really dismissive of the problems I am facing. And that all, in a way, in my opinion, leads to money. So we just need more funding for all of these. So, and those efforts that lead to standardizations. So yeah, give money to PsychDS, give money to ACLU, and give money to everyone who wants to develop classes, basically. That's my call. But yeah, to summarize, we might be in trouble in developmental psychology, as I said in the beginning, but we're also actively trying to dig ourselves out of it. And I think that's pretty cool.